We haven't seen the best of him yet. He's going to move up, probably move down, and conquer the whole world. He may even be a heavyweight.
Good test tonight against
Justin.
But
he deserves the money now. He needs to be paid.
Well, and
give the man the money.
Those people who are responsible for writing those checks are going to do their best.
Larry Mercer.
To make an...
That's right.
Yeah, Larry.
That's right,
get ready to write a check.
Well, I'll buy him a car.
I'm sure
Bob,
you will.
I won't give him $10 million. I'll give him $10 million.
Be careful what you say. You be very careful what you say. All right, so still to come tonight, the second of our two main events, and this one is the pivotal fight between Oscar De La Hoya and Oba Carr. Oba Carr, 48 wins, 2 losses, the losses only to Trinidad and Quarte. Now he fights the other reigning welterweight superstar in the well-known triumvirate, De La Hoya. And while we wait for that, let's look ahead to some other upcoming programs on HBO. For more boxing, mark the following dates on your calendar. Next Saturday, welterweight champion Felix Trinidad takes on Hugo Pineda. On June 5, light heavyweight title holders Roy Jones and Reggie Johnson face one another. And on June 19, Michael Grant meets Lou Savarese. Real Sports premieres this Tuesday night at 10 p.m. Eastern and Pacific, with stories on sports riots, hockey goons, and boxer Elvir Mariki, whose father and sister have returned to their homeland in their fight against the Yugoslavian Serbs. Beginning Monday, June 21, HBO Sports celebrates its 25th year of Wimbledon tennis, with 59 hours of weekday action accompanied each night by a one-hour highlight show. And then in August, Sports of the 20th Century presents Fists of Freedom, a documentary which looks back at the origin, the individuals, and the after effects of the moment when African-American athletes competing at the 1968 Summer Olympic Games changed the face of sports forever. Back live at ringside, and now with Larry Merchant, let's turn our attention to Oscar De La Hoya. Larry, a year ago at this time, Oscar De La Hoya was fighting somebody named Patrick Charpentier in a football stadium in El Paso. He was looking ahead to a meaningless rematch with the faded Julio Cesar Chavez, and he was basking in criticism for taking big money fights with no competitive impact on the sport. Now, here he is fighting the illustrious Oba Carr with a record of 48-2 between fights with Ike Quarte and the apparent matchup upcoming with Felix Trinidad. What happened to De La Hoya?
Well, Jim, he's always been a kind of ongoing, persistent work in progress. Always redefining himself between fights, before fights, during fights, and right after fights. You may remember that it wasn't too long ago he was saying, well, he wasn't going to fight that long, and he might turn out to be a golf pro or maybe an architect or an actor. But yesterday he told us that he's really found out what he wants to do with his life for the next 5 years. He wants to be a prize fighter. You may also remember that he was more or less a slugger and brawler early in his career, but then he decided he wanted to be Willie Pepper. Well, now he says he wants to go back and be more of a fighter, as he calls it. When you're Oscar De La Hoya, you can make those changes. It's all in the service of trying to be great and trying to be perfect. He told us that he took the fight with Quarte because his fans demanded a meaningful fight. He told us that he's taking the fight with Trinidad, assuming it can be all worked out, because he wants the fight. Let's not get too carried away here. There's also a minimum of $15 million involved. Oba Carr is the kind of fighter who can be very dangerous as any welterweight, if he's looking back to Quarte or ahead to Trinidad. De La Hoya is hungry enough and ambitious enough, you don't expect that, but there, anything can happen in a prize fight.
Well, and particularly against an opponent like Carr, as we mentioned, 48 wins, the losses only to Quarte and Trinidad. A fighter like Oba Carr, George Foreman, doesn't expect to be a 10-1 betting underdog, as is the case here against De La Hoya, so you know that his motivation will be sky high. But beyond that, what would he have to do to give Oscar trouble?
He's got to make certain that he only gets his rest once he gets on that stool. Fight 3 minutes every round, most of it moving backwards, side to side, and keeping Oscar circling him and following him in the circle. If he decides to rest, he can lose it all, but if he just takes it on, this challenge, win every round, don't lose one round, he can walk out here a victory. He's got the skills to do it.
Box with aggression.
You got to box, but yet keep it in a circular fashion so the judges can give him some, he's not running, so to speak. But you got to win every round, every minute. When you sit down on the stool, take a rest.
Good plan. Let's see if Obakar can pull it off against the Golden Boy, whose impact on the sport as a fighter is surpassed perhaps only by his impact as a marketable commodity. Not for nothing do they call Oscar De La Hoya the Golden Boy. As his promoter might say, it's all about the Benjamins. The sport may be troubled, but at the top end of the pay scale for athletes, boxers have nothing to apologize for. According to Forbes' 1997 survey, Oscar De La Hoya's $38 million trailed only Michael Jordan and Evander Holyfield in income for that year. Like Sugar Ray Leonard, who also enjoyed tremendous earning power, De La Hoya's path to stardom began at the Olympic Games.
The Olympics has been for the past 20 years the key springboard to any great professional career. And now the Olympics isn't televised on prime time anymore. Oscar may have been the last great Olympic fighter who had that built-in springboard.
American television viewers were captivated by the 19-year-old De La Hoya as he won Barcelona Olympic gold for his recently deceased mother. And his fame has only increased since he turned pro in November of 1992.
Oscar, number one, is good looking. Secondly, he's very, very articulate. Third, his intelligence comes through. And fourth, he's Hispanic, which is a big, big plus because companies want to reach this great emerging Hispanic market.
The question is, how does an athlete from a darker side sport like boxing become the cover boy for numerous national advertising campaigns?
Oscar's image has been very carefully constructed. At times, I think it may be a little bit of a fabricated image. But nonetheless, there is a definite image that has been sold to the public. It's paid off. You know, Madison Avenue has come running, and Oscar has all the endorsements.
To all beef patties, special sauce.
Is anyone here?
I told you, dial 10-10-3-2-1 to save money. 50% when you talk over 10 minutes.
I get angry in that ring. It's not me inside that ring. It's somebody else.
Through his endorsements, De La Hoya and his promoter carefully target the heart of his fan base.
I know what young kids want. I know what young kids want to see. And so I can give him a little bit of information, you know, on how a fight can be promoted towards a younger crowd.
And it doesn't stop here. Now Oscar is taking singing lessons for an upcoming album release. And his website collects an estimated 3 to 4 million hits in a two-week period surrounding each fight. De La Hoya admits all this fame comes with a price. But since he has abandoned the idea of applying for a conditional promoter's license to co-promote his own fights, business is back to normal.
2 months ago, it was a big distraction. But again, that's changed. Then all the endorsements, all the publicity I do, it's not a big distraction anymore. I think we're going to leave it at him being the promoter and just, of course, me helping out, but just me being the fighter.
Oscar De La Hoya has no plans to slow down his ever-expanding business life, which will include the introduction of a Team De La Hoya clothing line to 5,000 retail stores around the world.
With my image, who I am, what I represent, everything's going to skyrocket through, including pay-per-view buys, including my endorsements.
So far, everything De La Hoya touches has turned to gold, including millions of female fans' hearts around the country. More money. A projected fight with Felix Trinidad could boost De La Hoya's 1999 earnings to well over $40 million. Not bad for a Mexican-American kid from East L.A. So maybe we should put dollar signs on the tail of the tape, which shows you that De La Hoya and Carr, 1 year apart in age, they used to travel together on amateur boxing trips going all the way back to their days as contemporaries in the Junior Olympics. De La Hoya with a 1.5-inch height advantage. They both weighed in yesterday at 147. Carr has gained 11 pounds since the weigh-in. Oscar only 7, and a 1-inch reach advantage for De La Hoya. Punch stat numbers, Larry.
The numbers here are both Both fighters against Ike Corte. You can see again, Carr is the busier fighter. De La Hoya is much the harder puncher. Similarly with the jab, De La Hoya hasn't used his very hard jab to much effect in some fights. He might use it tonight.
Rules of the bout, with our unofficial ringside scorer, Harold Lederman.
The Escudero Oya Open Card fight is scheduled for 12 rounds using the unified rules of the Association of Boxing Commissions. There is no standing eight count, no three knockdown rule. Only the referee can stop the fight, and you cannot be saved by the bell in any round, including the 12th and final round. Jim.
Thank you, Harold.
Overcard. Incidentally, Jim, you mentioned the odds before. I should throw a couple of numbers out here. There has been some support for Carr in recent hours. The fight has gone down from 10-1 to 7-1. So some people are taking a shot with Carr, perhaps believing that De La Hoya will be distracted by the negotiations with Trinidad.
The undercard of De La Hoya Quarte, Oba Carr had to beat Frankie Randall to earn this title shot. And he proved his mettle that night, winning convincingly against Randall in what was a boxing match between the two men. Just as was the case with Floyd Mayweather, Oba Carr is trained by his daddy, Eddie Carr. Wearing the baseball cap a couple of shoulder levels behind Oba as they make their way into the ring. There's Eddie. And they trained at Big Bear in California at altitude, just as Mayweather did, just as De La Hoya does. The Carrs claim that in their 6 weeks of training in Big Bear, they never once ran into De La Hoya, prompting Larry to suggest that it's a much bigger town than he had thought.
I thought it was a general store and a few ski shops.
And we've mentioned several times that Oba Carr's only two losses were to Ike Quarte and Felix Trinidad. Trinidad in 94, Quarte in 96. Against that, 48 wins, one draw, 28 KOs. A highly professional, skilled boxer, Oba Carr. Once a long time ago at a Junior Olympics competition, Oscar De La Hoya handed a video camera to Oba Carr's dad, Eddie, and said, "Would you take my fight?" And Eddie said, "Absolutely, I'll do that for you, young man." Perhaps never dreaming that 11 years later, the two sons would meet for the welterweight title of the world. Has deals lined up down the road beyond the fights that he's about to enter the ring for. Oh, that's something new. Oscar shouting at himself to build the intensity.
It's not easy to wake up before a boxing match. All kind of ways to say to yourself, look, this is it. I'm here. Wake up. And you say it, finally, it may happen in two or three rounds, or happen walking up the steps. That's what you really want.
Well, the point I was about to make is he's been through the distraction of fighting when the deal is already on the table before. It's nothing new to him. It's just that this is the biggest deal yet. It was as big as the Quarte fight was. The Trinidad fight is bigger. Felix is better known.
You don't want to ship the crowd out. You want to make certain you know I'm in the ring. This is a fight. You want to say to yourself, it's a sparring match.
Oscar De La Hoya has had 30 previous fights. He's won them all. 24 KOs. Has not lost a bout since the 1991 World Championships, where he lost to Marcus Rudolph of East Germany, and he avenged that loss 1 year later in taking the gold medal at Barcelona. While you're watching this upcoming bout, you can also log on to www.hbo.com/boxing to chat, score each round of tonight's action, and comment on whether you like or dislike these exceptionally long fighter walk-ins to the arena here in the Mandalay Bay Hotel. Now let's go up to ring announcer Michael Buffer, the voice of champions.
Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Arum's Top Rank Incorporated, the Mandalay Bay Resort Casino Hotel of Las Vegas, Nevada, the Las Vegas Hilton, and your undisputed, undefeated King of Beers, Budweiser. This Bud's for You present 12 rounds of boxing for the WBC Welterweight Championship of the World. Sanctioned by the Nevada State Athletic Commission Chairman Dr. Elias Ghan, Commissioners Glenn Carano, Lorenzo Fertitta, Dr. Luther Mack, and Dr. James Nade, Executive Director Mark Ratner, Chief Physician Dr. Flip Homansky, Physicians at Ringside Dr. James Wishgame, Dr. William Berliner, and Dr. Margaret Goodman. Timekeeper and counting for the knockdown seconds will be James Cavan and Mike Lachella. At ringside for the World Boxing Council, President Jose Suleiman. Supervisor for the WBC, Rex Walker. The three judges scoring this contest on a 10-point must system will be Carol Castellano, Chuck Jampa, and Jerry Roth. And when the bell rings, your referee in charge of the action working for the 152nd time in a world title bout, Richard Steele. And now, from 60 square acres of the hottest and most exciting real estate here in Las Vegas, the Mandalay Bay Resort Casino, for the thousands in attendance and the millions watching around the world, ladies and gentlemen, introducing first, fighting out of the blue corner, wearing black with white, and weighing in at 147 pounds. He enters the ring with a reputation as a masterful boxer and brings an outstanding professional record to back it, consisting of 48 victories, 28 by knockout with only two losses and one draw. Tonight, he plans to make the ultimate step in his career to shock the world and leave this ring as a champion. Ladies and gentlemen, here is your challenger from Detroit, Michigan, the number 4 ranked contender in the world, Oba Motor City Car! And across the ring, fighting out of the red corner, wearing blue and weighing in also at 137 pounds. In 1992, he captured Olympic gold, and now, as a professional, he has a perfect record. 30 bouts, 30 victories, including 24 knockouts, while earning 4 world titles and the recognition as, pound for pound, one of the best in the world. Ladies and gentlemen, from East LA, presenting the former junior lightweight world champion, former lightweight world champion, former super lightweight world champion, and now the reigning and defending undefeated WBC welterweight champion of the world, the Golden Boy, Oscar De La Hoya.
Okay, I gave both of you instructions in the dressing room. I'm cautioning again, obey my commands at all times. I give 1-2 warnings after that, points will be deducted. Shake hands, good luck.
Oscar De La Hoya, being a smart young man, has noticed that he's finished his fights very strongly. He's promised now that since that worked, maybe he ought to start strongly. Let's see.
De La Hoya with a new clothing contract, therefore a new color scheme, and also the shortest trunks we've seen in the ring in a while. Wonder if he designed them himself.
Those trunks are as short as the things you wore in the 68 Olympics, George.
Short all, baby. What I don't like is Oscar having a hard time warming up prior to the fight. Even his trainer was hitting him in the side and in the back, trying to make life come to him. So few people have given Carr a chance. You wonder how difficult it's been for Deloya to maintain his concentration on this bout, but he's always conquered that obstacle in the past.
Well, Carr's got to move around, land a shot, forget about the power, just put something on Delahoya to win every round. Pressure is on Oscar to get a knockout. He's got to stick his jab out there and dig hard. But Obakar has the luxury of just winning round after round.
That's that quick little right hand that is one of Carr's better punches.
It was that quick little right hand up the middle that floored Trinidad in the second round of his bout with Felix back in 94. Deloya landing a left hand and Carr seeming to wobble for a moment.
Yeah, a left jab it was, Jim.
One more than hard a punch. And Deloya promised that he would not be cautious in the first round, and he is not. A left hook produces an early knockdown.
Those punches did not look hard, which isn't to say they weren't. They just didn't have the appearance of being punches with great leverage.
And there's a rumor that Carr is badly overtrained, George. Some of those who saw him in Big Bear saying too many rounds of sparring, too much running. If a fighter's overtrained, does he have trouble taking punches?
No, that's not the problem. It's mostly it'll all be affected with the accuracy of his punches.
And the fact that he's getting into exchanges against a stronger man.
Yeah, you don't know. Another left, and that left throws Carr's knees momentarily.
And he's not moving. Obakar should be on the move here. Left and right. Left and right.
Big first round for Oscar De La Hoya. Carr trying to fight back now in the last 30 seconds of the round.
Keep him up.
He's falling into the web of Oscar De La Hoya's power now. You got to keep moving. You just can't be there. And your punches shouldn't have any power. When Obakar throws the punch, just slightly enough to keep him off balance.
Carr trying to fire a hard right hand.
Carr has recovered his balance nicely. He is a very courageous fighter.
Oscar followed him around without a jab.
But in all probability, Obakar starts the fight 2 points down because that was likely a 10-8 round for De La Hoya as the result of the knockdown.
Okay, don't bend in on it. In and out, side to side. Yeah, you lost the first round. So, but still, we ain't lost the war. We're still in the fight. Put that square right there. The square right there, Avery.
You got it. You got it in the body. You got it.
It was a stiff jab that first startled Carr, and there you see him going down from a short left hook inside. Left to the body. De La Hoya promised to start faster than he customarily has, and he has delivered on the promise.
Let's go, let's go!
So in round one, by copy box numbers, Obakar landing 9 of 72 punches, De La Hoya 25 of 56, an unusually aggressive first round for Oscar, backing up his claim that he would be a more aggressive fighter than has been the case for the past few years.
Oscar De La Hoya is doing a great job of keeping his hands up. He's not dropping his hands. Generally, he gets comfortable. He puts his left hand to his side so he can get more range. He's being extra careful not to do that tonight. Obakar's doing a terrible job of staying in front of De La Hoya.
Meaning he's not moving enough.
No, you got to move. If you want to stand in front of him later on, you get to know him, get his rhythm, maybe 5 or 6 rounds. But right now, it's not a good idea. Oscar's got to give him a bit of respect. You just can't just walk right over. Pick your shots and do the same thing.
Deloya fighting the first minute of the second round the way he's fought so many first rounds in the past, mostly looking and setting himself up for opportunities down the road.
And they've got to sell Oscar De La Hoya back on his left jab. You want to keep that jab in the business. It's a good jab. You don't want to desert it, man. Stay right with your left jab.
Obakar beating Oscar to the punch through the middle portions of round two now. And Oscar not throwing much as Carr begins to score.
Now, Obakar is allowed to lay on Oscar's neck. The taller guy's going to get the worst of it. Start to affect your legs a little bit. His corner, I start warning the referee now, get him off my neck, get off my fighter's neck.
Eloy trying to dig the left of the body. The thing about the jab for De La Hoya, Carr is a set-up fighter, George. He likes to set up, mount an attack, walk a few steps, set up, and do it again. If you keep the jab in his face, it's hard for him to set up and start a rhythm.
Yeah, but Oscar's having problems because if you don't throw a stiff left jab, you're not going to be able to follow it with a good right hand. So you have to just put your right hand down for a while. And that's what he's not wanting to do right now. He wants to keep the right hand in the show, too. Just lay off the right hand and just stiff jab him for a while.
Oscar is coming forward as promised, but in this round he hasn't been shooting many punches.
If Oscar only could understand the damage he can do with his left jab, but he has done.
Another right hand by Carr. Obakar appearing to outwork Oscar De La Hoya in round two.
Oh yeah, he's trying to win this round.
This is a very good round for Obakar. This is the pattern he would like to follow in this fight.
And as we go to De La Hoya's corner to listen to Roberto Alcazar speak Spanish occasionally, our interpreter is Ray Torres.
Okay, you got to start just doing a little bit more. You got to use that jab a little bit more and move around a little more. You don't stay in front of him. Okay, you need to use that jab more. Make sure that that's what you need to do. And relax in there. Every time you get him to the corner, make work the body. Work the body.
Dos, tres golpes, cuerpo.
Stay out of in front of him. Keep breaking on with that jab. One rest.
You saw in that last round why Obakar has been such a good professional fighter, coming back from a first round knockdown and establishing himself and winning the round, in my judgment.
And De La Hoya throwing only 8 power punches in the round. You can see that Harold Letterman also thought that Carr won the second.
And a good stiff jab from De La Hoya to open up his attack here.
Obakar's got the luxury now of being able to stay in position and let your opponent come to you. That's what you want in boxing. He's done a good job of staying in position. He never pushes his right leg behind his left leg behind his right leg.
But he appeared to be momentarily hurt by a left hand again, and Oscar has unloaded more left hand artillery here in the third round. It's almost as though the second round didn't exist as De La Hoya comes up in round three and begins to pick up on the damage that he created for Carr in round one.
Well, that like Obakar, you really got to count that into the cost of your building. You're going to get hit and you're going to get hurt, but you got to recover and get right back to your strategy. He bends his waist here and there, which is fine. He's never out of position. Right foot is always behind the left. He's got Oscar hunting for a knockout. He's the champion.
Good right hand by Carr.
De La Hoya lands a little right of his own in retaliation. And De La Hoya is active with his left hand, particularly when he fires left hooks. Carr has trouble handling that. When De La Hoya sits back, Carr can attack, be aggressive, and control long stretches of the fight.
Now Carr has moved the tide because he's inside where he wants to be. He's not having to back away. Whenever Oscar throws a shot, he's inside waiting on everything to finish. He's not away from it.
Come on, Oscar!
The mistake is you don't want to get into exchanges with a good champion like Oscar.
Good left hook inside by Cargo, and that stopped Oscar momentarily in his tracks.
The car is at this point beating Oscar to the punch.
Yep, and he's doing a good job of it. The power is not in his shots. His strategy is working. Oscar does not have a strategy tonight. Just following around a good fighter. He's following around without a jab. Haven't thrown three combinations yet. Carr being first, now Delahoya coming back. You heard Eddie Carr asking his son at the end of round two, be first.
Now Oscar's starting to drop his left hand, which is the worst habit he has.
Most of this fight is taking place in about a 10-foot ring inside the bigger ring.
Andrew Ramirez returned from Kosovo, where he was held for a period of time as a prisoner of war. The Southern Californian wanted to meet Oscar De La Hoya here as Oscar's guest at ringside tonight. Chairman of the board of Time Warner, Gerald Devin, right behind him.
Just keep breaking him down. Keep stepping to him first. Keep using your jab in your right hand. Right hand to the body, hooks to the body, and stepping around it. Keep using it, all right? Keep using it. You breaking him down. It's the wall. Who want it now? You got him. You're taking him out there in the deep water. So just keep using your jab. Keep punching in bunches.
And don't forget the body. The body.
As with Mayweather in the earlier fight, Carr's best punch has been that quick right hand right over the top. Keeping him in this fight, which now may be even in points.
Harold, how do you have it through three?
Jim, even in points. I agree with Larry. 28-28. Actually, 2 rounds to 1 over Carr. Jim, I got to tell you something. You got to go along with the referee and call that first round 10-8 De La Hoya. But as replays the show later, I really believe Oscar was holding over Carr behind the head with his right hand when he hit him with the left and dropped him. It was a holding and hitting thing that Steele didn't see. But since he didn't call it, it's 10-8 Oscar for the first round.
Well, if you're looking for a new De La Hoya style, this De La Hoya looks to me like the guy who fought Julio Cesar Chavez and elected to slug it out with him toe-to-toe. It would appear, if this is the new style, that Oscar's going to offer out more contact, but he's going to take more punches in return.
Obakar's doing a fine job because he has a strategy. Oscar's only looking for a knockout, and this is a fine boxer, Oscar De La Hoya. He has great legs. He's got a good left jab. He's not using any skills at this point.
So he is shortchanging his own talent.
Yeah, he's just throwing away everything he's ever worked for. You don't want to do that. This is a business. You don't want to be hit. Obakar's got a strategy. He realizes he's not the best fighter in the ring tonight, and his strategy is working. Good overhand rights every now and then. He never tries to finish Oscar once he hurt him.
They trade again, and Carr is first and last in the exchange.
Oscar's got to get that jab working and work on his combination and use his legs a little bit.
Now the crowd begins to wake up a little and understand what they're seeing, which is that after the lopsided round one in De La Hoya's favor, Obakar is very much in the fight.
And that was a good left hook to the body by Obakar. So we don't want this fight, if you're in Oscar's corner, to continue to go round after round after round.
Why isn't Oscar throwing more jabs?
Oscar decided to be aggressive. A jab is more effective when you're circling your opponent.
There it is.
Moving around a little bit. You can see he backs up and he gets the jab again.
Yeah, when he's not throwing the jab, Obakar can decide what he wants to do. He doesn't have to be fearful of anything, of being thrown off balance. When the jab isn't there, Carr is a little quicker with that right hand especially.
You want to jab and slide back just a little bit so that this guy can look at you and you can hit him again with it.
Left hook to the body by De La Hoya, but Carr was landing his own left hook in return at the same time.
A triple left hook, as it were.
De La Hoya starting to throw the jab a little more, but again, I make my point. When Oscar doesn't throw the jab, Carr can walk to a spot he likes, set up, and mount his attack. If Oscar keeps punching, Oba can't do that.
Oba Carr is making a mistake. You don't want to punch with a puncher.
You gotta sit down.
Just relax and stay busy with a jab. Just move, move, keep moving. Don't stay still in the front. Oscar, da la combinación de esos dos golpes.
You gotta give me two punch combination at least.
La derecha.
And watch out for his right hand.
Escucha.
Okay. Hooks and stuff like that. Lean to the side. Again, the angle. Give me some water right there.
Right hand and the uppercut going. Mm-hmm. Don't throw me the hook after the uppercut. Throw a straight right hand. You're already sitting there. Just pop real quick.
Hit it right at the chest.
Oscar De La Hoya's father, Joel De La Hoya, himself a former fighter.
Second.
Amateur style.
In his hometown of Durango, Mexico. Oscar assures us that his dad, Joel De La Hoya, remains a part of the inner circle, although the inner circle is going to be narrowed after this fight.
Oscar has done a good job of body punching.
Keep him up, keep him up.
A few times the referee is saying keep him up, but those punches are getting right into that navel.
Now, I'm sitting here as I watch this fight and watch Carr fight an excellent fight. What the people thought early on when we, in our introductions, we were just hyping Carr to make it seem like more of a fight. Well, now you can see what we were talking about. This man is not the ideal tune-up for a bigger fight.
Has got determination like no one you've ever seen.
And he exerts some of that determination in going to Carr's body.
Tremendous body shots by Oscar. His best fusillade of the night.
But Carr handling the De La Hoya thunder better than he did earlier in the fight.
He's not handling it. He's just waiting his turn. Those shots hurt and it takes a moment. Now Oscar's backing up for a little oxygen himself. Oscar's starting to back up a little bit so he can see a better range for his left jab. I like that now. I want to just walk into him, make him reach and exert himself. Obakar's been doing a good job because Oscar's been coming to him. Now Oscar's got to jab him and back up and bring him into his power.
Oscar blocking Carr's last right hand with his glove. Working the jab, but only sporadically is De La Hoya, and now Carr lands another right hand lead.
This is what happens when you just decide you're not going to listen to your people in the corner. You're out there alone. It's a hard fight. You can win, but you got to discard because you're not listening. Oscar's chief corner man told him, sit down, let us do our job. And you can see they've had a... Obakar's doing a good job, but once he starts this power hunting, head hunting, he can get himself into big trouble. Now Obakar's backing up, moving side to side.
For the moment, fifth round almost complete. Carr continuing to hold his own and maybe more so against Oscar De La Hoya.
Viva.
You got the timing with that right hand to the body and that right hand upper chin and that straight right hand down the middle. Do it off the jab. Sometimes when you throw the right hand, squat and go back up under the chin with the left hand if he ain't punching, okay? I mean, squat and go back up under the chin with your right uppercut if he ain't punching. He's trying to hit you with the hook.
Okay?
We'll take your time.
It's hard.
trabajando. Se más trabajo.
You gotta keep working. Don't give him the ring. Make sure you pressure him. Don't let him get into close. He's throwing the right hand at you. Be careful with that.
But be busy. Let's go, second. Be first. Be busy. Okay? I'll hustle him. With your punch.
Obakar's father said we would see something supernatural tonight. I don't know if this is supernatural, but it's a real fight, certainly exceeding the expectations of most of us.
And though we're less than halfway into the bout, already your mind wanders to the subject of a possible decision. There's a core of opinion among cynics in the sport, reinforced by the scoring in De La Hoya Whittaker and De La Hoya Quarte, that Oscar has a hard time losing a decision. But what if Obakar clearly wins several rounds? It's not out of the question.
Yeah, but Oscar has gotten out there and tried to fight and win every fight he's been into, so you don't want to label him that kind of guy. This guy's a winner.
As he proved in the 12th round against Quarte.
He hasn't had any gift, even right now, when he could be boxing and moving. His corner has not even told him to do much about moving. He's still out there trying to win. Call him the golden boy, but he's no soft touch. I like Obakar's fight. He's been able to just touch him every now and then. Nothing hard, just touch him. Then he periodically lands some power to keep Oscar honest. Standing around waiting for one shot.
Fascinating. Absolutely fascinating to watch him fight this way, George.
Yeah, look like an old plotter or something.
I mean, this is a guy who has boxing skills, immense boxing skills. And you just wonder why a fighter with all that craft built up over the years would renounce his boxing skills to try to fight as a slugger.
You never know what happened. But when you have a corner and you can't listen, boy, there's not much else you have. Obakar staying right with his strategy. Takes a few left jabs here and there. Stays with it.
Obakar, for the most part, busier than De La Hoya. Wobbled through the first round, survived the knockdown, probably fell behind by 2 points on every scorecard, but since then has been able to execute his plan.
He just touches Oscar, touches his gloves every now and then, touch here, touch there, just to keep Oscar starting all over again. Every time he touches his hand, Oscar has to start all over.
De La Hoya with a cobra-like left-hand counter in there. Tries to get past Obakar toward a possible matchup with Felix Trinidad.
Obakar has landed a number of low blows this fight, but they've been really borderline low blows, most of them, none of them down in Tierras del Fuego like that. None of them have seemed to have bothered De La Hoya especially. You can see his protector just beneath the white on top of his trunks.
But it doesn't protect you. Believe me. You'll have to be singing some high notes on those.
Of course, along about now, people are going to start to try to compare De La Hoya's fight with Obakar and Trinidad's fight with Obakar. Trinidad stopping Carr in 8 rounds, just as they compared the two fighters in their fights against Whittaker.
First round, Oscar De La Hoya starts to bounce a little bit in his feet. Man, what kind of shoes
he has. Always felt like he's most effective when he bounces, George.
He gets a couple of bounces, and he's got his rhythm. He can do anything.
Harold, how do you have it halfway through?
Jim, in rounds I got it all even 3-3, but Oscar De La Hoya winning the fight by 1 point, 57-56 on a 10-point must system due to the knockdown. Jim, I got to tell you, in that last round, I didn't see Oscar De La Hoya doing a thing. And I'll be honest with you, I really believe he's not moving inside because he got headbutted in the first round, and he's nervous about getting headbutted again. Steele didn't see it the first round, but boy, he got headbutted.
Working with the left hand, setting up the occasional right. He is outboxing champion Oscar De La Hoya right now.
Goes left, he goes right, he catches Oscar waiting, and he hits him. Never too hard.
In the last round, De La Hoya threw only 40 punches.
Blood streaming
from the
below
left
the left eye of De La Hoya, perhaps on a butt.
1 point.
He's taking a point away for a headbutt.
Yeah, that intentional. He called it intentional.
He called that an intentional headbutt?
He did indeed. So referee Richard Steele removes another point from Obakar. To go with the point that he almost certainly lost on the knockdown in the first round. And now an angry De La Hoya comes back. De La Hoya trying to land the one big left hook that would punish Carr for the butt.
When you do that, you end up getting butted again. Got to keep you cool.
Yesterday, Gil Clancy, advisor to De La Hoya's trainer Robert Alcazar, told us that he would go to referee Richard Steele, intentionally bald, to point out that intentionally bald Obakar might use his head as a butting weapon.
Yeah, but I would prefer a guy bald to butt me than a guy with hair, because that's where the scratches get in. You can, a string of hair kind of slides up.
I still want to see the replay to see whether it looked deliberate.
De La Hoya landing a good counter left hook inside, and De La Hoya bouncing and more active than has been the case before. Carr lands a right hand on the swollen cheek, and another one.
It's the bounce on his legs. Keep the bounce, Oscar. Obakar should just keep moving, land the shot here and there, and keep moving. Make certain they don't stop this fight.
The bleeding and the swelling will be below Oscar's left eye, so they should not interfere with his vision.
But if they happen to stop this fight because of the butt,
1 point, no blood,
loses it.
And now Richard Steele removes another point from Obakar for low blows. So Carr has lost two penalty points in this round.
Obakar's better realize if he want to win this fight, he better get a knockout.
Let's take a look first. Larry, here's your look at the butt. You wanted to see what Richard Steele called an intentional butt.
Let's take a look as they come in at close quarters. Both fighters have been aggressive. Now, that is not a deliberate butt. I don't know if the rules say you can take a point away for that, but that is not a deliberate butt.
It's a damaging one, but maybe not deliberate. Harold, what do you think?
Okay, here's what happened. Stop using that word deliberate. He called an accidental headbutt. Oscar De La Hoya was cut under the left eye by an accidental headbutt. Richard Steele does not have to take away a point on an accidental headbutt.
But he did.
Okay? He took away 1 point.
Why?
Because Oscar De La Hoya suffered a cut. It was an accidental butt. Steele may have said that, hey, Carr butted him enough in this fight. Another accidental headbutt caused the cut, so he took away a point. But it wasn't intentional. Intentionally takes away 2 points. Now, what this means is if the fight gets stopped because of that cut, we go to the scorecards.
Yeah, okay, we all understand that, Harold, but why is Richard Steele once again imposing himself on a championship fight by calling that accidental butt a foul?
Larry, there is...
Forget it.
Because of the damage that was done is apparently Harold's point there.
But it's not interfering with the fight. It's not... De La Hoya is fighting his fight. The blood is not going into his eye. No, you know, it was an accidental butt, period.
And so there will be something else to debate in Richard Steele's ongoing dossier of memorable ring decisions. He's the man, of course, who stopped Chavez Taylor with 2 seconds to go in the fight, and Chavez, having lost on two scorecards, made him the victor by TKO. A lot of people thought that was the right decision. Then several months later, he stopped the fight between Mike Tyson and Razor Ruddock. Most people thought that was a premature stoppage, and from that moment forward, Steele has been booed every time he's been introduced as the referee of a major bout here.
You know, everybody's entitled to make mistakes. I've never brought this up again, but since you did...
Two hard left hooks by De La Hoya, and Carr grabbing and holding on.
Let's get to the fight.
Oscar's been able to land some left uppercuts.
He's made his left hand more of a factor in the bout, which is what I personally think he always has to do when he's in trouble, George.
Yeah, that left hand is his groceries.
It's his Sunday punch. Yeah. It's his meal ticket.
He should have been bouncing and jabbing, and then you just wonder, is Oscar getting old soon or what? It reminds me of me. There you go, Oscar. Use your legs. The Obakar's got to make certain that he goes left and right so the movement of Oscar's leg doesn't affect what he's doing. Don't move straight in.
Fascinating suggestion, George. You're wondering if Oscar De La Hoya has gotten old already. He's 26.
It doesn't take long. When you stop using your legs, it's not good news.
And of course, with regard to any comparison between De La Hoya's meeting with Carr and Trinidad's meeting with Carr, remember that Felix Trinidad fought Carr back in 1994.
Now look at Oscar, how well he moves. Why hasn't he been moving all night?
So he's moving. Because when he moves, he's not punching, and he's the stronger puncher in this fight. He should be imposing his strength on Carr.
Oscar, we need to work more. You need to box more.
¿Cuántos combinaciones juntas?
You gotta put your combinations together.
Keep in here. Way up.
Vamos.
We gotta keep going now.
Trabaja.
You gotta work.
No lo dejes que entre.
Don't let him come inside.
Respira, descansa.
Go ahead. Take a deep breath. Relax now.
No more chances. You're not taking any more chances.
The cup. Very early in the round where you could see those remarkably quick hands of De La Hoya. But he gets a little bit wild sometimes. That left hand would have sent a lesser man flying across the ring. Obakar is no lesser man.
Fascinating challenge for the ringside scorers as the pattern obtains through most of the bout. De La Hoya landing more punches, Carr throwing many more. So if you're looking strictly for punch output and activity, Carr is the leader in that category.
Now Oscar's got to be the counter puncher in this round. He only hits after he's been hit.
Obakar has been the distance many times in his career, more often in fact than De La Hoya. But he has shown a tendency, as he showed against Frankie Randall earlier this year, to fade a little bit in the last two rounds.
He's come geared for the fight of his life. A lot of people thought that Obakar had gone downhill. He's obviously trained, motivated to give the best effort he possibly can, and even better in this fight.
Oscar, now he's bouncing good. Now, Obakar's got to make sure that he goes left and right. That's what throws the bouncing off, not coming foul.
With one of his own, as Steele steps in and momentarily stops the action.
Sometimes you want to drop your hand out of the sight of your opponent, keep him guessing so he doesn't jump in too much. You always want to know where your guy's hands are. Obakar stopped.
Whenever he bleeds in the fight, Oscar De La Hoya feels he hasn't fought the fight he wanted to fight, but certainly the bleeding here has nothing to do with the fight he's trying to fight.
He's gotten accustomed to swelling under his left eye. It happened against Miguel Angel Gonzalez. It happened against Chavez. Obviously, it'll be the case from the butt tonight.
And some bruise coming up because Oscar has decided that he wanted to dance a little.
And there's nothing wrong with that. Use your skills. You got them, use them.
But he's again allowing Carr to establish the activity contrast as Oba throws most of the punches.
He seemed to think that he can take the round by way of a knockdown or something, so he loses the round intentionally almost.
Keep in mind, De La Hoya with a likely cushion on the scorecards, knocked down in round one, and then in round eight, a point penalty to Carr for butting and another point penalty for hitting low.
Double Carr's excellent fight. Excellent fight.
Keep winning rounds like that, okay? Keep that jab going.
Keep that round.
Reva, you in shape to fight all day. You in shape to fight all day, baby.
Good job, baby.
Yeah. We got three rounds to go.
That's all we have.
Is three rounds, so you got to keep boxing him.
No problem.
Is there a new one up on the hairline on the other side?
No. No.
3 rounds to go, Oscar.
Three rounds.
Here you go.
Keep stepping to him.
You're going to finish everything with a jab over here.
Finish everything with a jab.
You know, I get the feeling that the crowd here is a little bit stunned by what's going on.
Yeah, I think a victory for Oscar was a foregone conclusion.
They came here for a celebration, a coronation, and the fight broke out.
How do you have it through nine?
You know, Jim, it's a very, very interesting fight. There's no question. In rounds, 5-4, very close, Oscar De La Hoya. In points, which is what counts, 86-82, a commanding 4-point lead for De La Hoya. Because how do you overcome a 2-point round in round one, a 3-point round in round seven? That's Overcar's problem. He's got to win a lot more rounds. He virtually has to win every one of the last 3 rounds to win this fight.
It's a real close fight. Mainly because Overcar is doing what he wants to do. Oscar's doing what he has to do.
No holding. Great.
He's turned it into a war.
All three judges are from here in Las Vegas.
He's able to miss a body shot, move around the ring, and nothing happens to him. Oscar just waits. You gotta make them pay. Now Oscar's allowing Overcar to step forward with his left jab.
In round nine, the pattern once again obtained. De La Hoya landed more punches. Carr threw more. Now they trade pretty equally in round 10.
Carr is doing a good job, but he don't want to get into a slug fist with Oscar De La Hoya.
After that first round knockdown, Carr's shown a pretty good chin. He has taken some thunderous left hooks. And, of course, he landed body punches early against De La Hoya. Maybe to take some of the steam out of those punches.
You know, we've celebrated Carr's chin, and rightly so. And although Carr does not punch anywhere near as hard as Oscar, he's hit Oscar with a lot of clean punches, and Oscar's chin is held up.
Oscar's got a good chin. You can put Oscar down for a big heart because he keeps coming. Take a break, right back for a knockout.
After the 12th round of the Quarte fight, it would be hard to call Oscar's heart into question.
He threw a left hook to the body that time. It was probably the best shot of the whole night.
And that left hook to the body, setting up two uppercuts that backed Carr up.
Carr's got to make certain he stay away from the left hand of Oscar.
El Hoyo with another clenching left hook. And another uppercut.
I can hear Oscar breathing hard from here at ringside.
Yeah, because being a puncher takes a lot of oxygen. A very good last minute of the 10th round for Oscar De La Hoya. Could another rally be coming to close the fight?
No problem. Open your mouth and get some water there. All right.
Two to go. Those masks.
Two more rounds, Oscar.
Two to go. Don't get killed.
Now relax. Come here. Here. Also, this is a very good round for you. A very good round.
Okay,
keep boxing now.
Boxing, three of the next 4 weeks here, followed by Wimbledon.
Let's make him pay for them stealing it from you, huh? Let's make him pay. You gotta work for it. Come on.
I wonder how this fight will change the perception of Oscar's fight with Trinidad, if it does at all. Out here in the West and Southwest, Oscar is a clear favorite. Back East, it no doubt the support will be for Trinidad.
Oscar's got the bounce into his legs again. Obakar is wondering. He sits there and think about what he's going to do because Oscar's moving, fanning shots away. That's the Oscar De La Hoya we know right there. That's the Oscar. You know, Obakar's got to, this can't make a, you got to be a moving target.
Another left hand by De La Hoya, and down goes Carr again. Four, five, what a shot.
Obakar does not want any more of that.
Come to me. Well, once come again, that'll change the perception.
Goodbye. And Steele says that'll do it. Obakar just couldn't get it together, and Richard Steele stops the fight. A TKO for De La Hoya.
Well, De La Hoya has shown that he could close the deal in and out of the ring.
The master of the late rounds once again strikes with an 11th round stoppage of Obakar. He really set it up, George, with that blistering last minute of the 10th round. He landed virtually every power shot down the stretch of the 10th round, and that softened Carr up for what came in the 11th.
Most importantly, he started to get the bounce into his legs. He's just an ordinary fighter without the bounce. He's better realize that, and don't revert to the old man stuff. He doesn't want to be a George Foreman. He want to be the golden
slugger.
Boy.
Yeah, flat-footed slugger who walks his man down.
Yeah, you don't want that. He doesn't need it. He's got the legs. Use them. Once those legs are pumping.
So just like Trinidad did in 1984, Oscar De La Hoya hurts Carr too badly for Carr to be able to finish the fight. Trinidad's TKO of Carr came in the 8th round. De La Hoya does it in the 11th in a fight in which Carr had given Oscar a lot of trying moments. But when he gets his left hand into play, like that, he's a superior fighter.
Most importantly, he fell right on his face. That's not what you want to see.
It's hard to recover.
Oscar's got the power.
Manny looks at this classic left-hand counter shot.
You know, he stood up straight and used his height. So Obakar threw a left hook, yet Oscar was out of range because of his height advantage, and yet he used his reach advantage to get that little extra inch in there that he has in the advantage, and he clocked it.
And knocked the man down and eventually out, even though he was leaning away as he threw the punch.
Because of the reach advantage, he has it, and his power is all in his hands. There's not much in his arms.
I'm tempted to say it's all in his left hand. He wouldn't knock a man down and out like that with his right hand.
No.
Michael Buffer is ready with the official particulars.
Ladies and gentlemen, here at the Mandalay Bay Resort Casino of Las Vegas, referee Richard Steele, following the knockdown, calls a halt to the bout at 55 seconds of round number 11, the winner, and still the undefeated WBC welterweight champion of the world from East Bay. Oscar De La Hoya!
punch stat numbers, and you can see that De La Hoya landed 83 more punches than Carr. Carr threw 241 more punches than De La Hoya, thus the dramatic difference in connect percentage. Our scorecards show us, incidentally, that Oscar De La Hoya was ahead on the three scorecards, 96, 91, 95, 92, 97, 90 going into the last two rounds. So on one of the three scorecards, at least, his margin was bolstered by the two penalty points awarded by Richard Steele in the seventh round, but he was clearly safe and away on the other two scorecards. Power punch numbers show that Obakar did better in that regard, landing 34% of his power punches against De La Hoya, and Oscar may want to clean that stat up a little bit as he gets ready to go against the two-fisted power of Felix Trinidad. De La Hoya landing more than half his power shots here. Let's go to Larry Merchant in the ring.
Thank you, Jim. All right, Oscar, congratulations on another victory. A little tougher than you thought it would be.
You know what, this guy, no, he can take a punch. He was ready. Like I said, every opponent I have, they lift themselves to the moon, to the sky, so he was ready. But, it was a good fight.
In a number of rounds, he was simply beating you to the punch, and you seemed a little bit off-put until you established yourself. What was going on?
I was ready. I didn't feel tired. I didn't get tired. I felt very strong. But,
do you feel you made the transition to being the kind of aggressive fighter that you said you wanted to be in this fight?
Oh, yeah. I pressed the fight in the first round. Second round, little personal problem that I had that I will mention. But after that...
What was it? What is a problem you can't mention?
I would rather not, because I have an opponent, September 18th, Felix Trinidad. I'm going to get you. Come on, bring it on. We're going to fight. Let's do it.
Okay. I'll take your cue then. Why are you calling out Felix Trinidad? He should be calling you out, presumably. Why do you want him so badly?
Because we're going to fight September 18th. He finally signed the contract. Let's do it. That's my next fight, September 18th. We're going to do it. And I'm ready, and he's ready. It's going to be the fight of the century, I guarantee.
Were you measuring yourself against Trinidad in terms of his fight with Carr when he stopped Carr in the eighth round tonight?
After the second, third round, I couldn't do the things I wanted to do. A little personal problem that I kind of encountered.
You couldn't do the things you wanted to do. I mean, does it have something to do with your stomach?
No, just something physical, yes, but I rather might not mention it because it's kind of personal.
Kind of personal. Okay, I won't go any...
The low blows.
All right. Were the low blows bothering you, actually?
No.
Because you didn't show any discomfort during the fight.
Nothing bothered me, nothing. I was physically ready.
What about the butt? I mean, it was an accidental butt, but a point was taken away. Did it have any impact on you at all?
No, not the head butt, not the low blows, nothing. He's a great fighter, good fighter, a good solid fighter.
Should we take anything out of the fact that in the last couple of rounds you started to move your legs more, started to get a little distance, and then the knockout came?
Yeah, that's where the personal problems occurred. I had to use my legs more. You know, I kind of sense he got tired. So, yeah, I did a kind of, not showboat, but kind of jump up and down and kind of counter him, you know, make him make mistakes. But either way, if this personal problem wouldn't occurred, he would have been out.
It's all right. I'll leave it to other reporters to unearth that, and I'm sure they will. All right. We'll get to Obakar in a moment and ask him his opinion about Oscar De La Hoya versus Felix Trinidad. Back to you, Jim, for a moment.
All right. Thanks very much, Larry. Let's start by asking George Foreman his opinion about Oscar De La Hoya versus Felix Trinidad. What would Oscar have to do differently against Trinidad?
Well, Oscar's proven to me he's the toughest guy in welterweight and middleweight I've seen in a long time. He's the golden boy. He has everything going for himself, but he constantly seeks a knockout. And why these guys continuously pursue him with this power, I don't understand. Oscar has nothing to prove in my mind. Believe me, it's up to Trinidad now to climb this hill.
So Oscar was looking too hard for a knockout, but Carr followed him around and made it possible. Right?
You can't do that.
Let's go back to Larry with Obakar.
All right, thank you. Oba, that was a terrific fight you gave. Was the knockdown in the first round a two-point round, and the 2 points he took away from you later in the fight make you any more desperate as the fight went on that you knew you had to knock him out?
First of all, I really thank God, the Lord Jesus Christ, for giving me the strength to just, you know, make it to the 11th round. But, you know, I could have been a little faster today and just, you know, worked off my lateral movement and my stick and my jab a little bit more. But
you found him easy to hit in many rounds, didn't you?
I found him easy to hit, you know. But, you know, I think that, you know, I could have gotten the fight a little bit better with my jab. But, you know, he's a quick fighter. But I think that, you know, I could have just, you know, used a little bit more transition in the fight.
Thank you for a terrific fight. Just one question. Fans want to know your opinion of De La Hoya versus Trinidad. You've been in the ring with both of them.
I think it would be a good fight. Both of them are fast fighters. Both of them. De La Hoya is a little bit more evasive. I think that, you know, both fighters have to just be careful. They get caught, you know, they get dropped. You know, this is a tough business, so, you know, we got to just train and just do the best we can.
So you don't see from your perspective, which is the best perspective, that either one has any particular advantage?
Both of them is just astronomical fighters, and I can't take neither one of them for granted, so I really can't call it. You know, you just got to get in there and just whoever's a tougher warrior that night will prevail.
Thank you very much, Oba.
Thank you.
Jim?
52nd professional fight for Oba Carr, and what a badge of honor he now gets to wear, as in his long career in the welterweight division, he has three losses to the three reigning cult welterweight icons of his era, Felix Trinidad, Ike Quarte, and Oscar De La Hoya, kind of like Jerry Quarry back in the heavyweight division,
yeah,
when he was just good enough to lose to the great fighters in the division.
I call Quarry the best heavyweight to never become heavyweight champ of the world.
Yeah,
Oba Carr was good tonight, very good, a lot better than Oscar thought.
Oh yeah, Oba Carr fought very well, and he's the best welterweight who will never in this era become a welterweight champion of the world. George, good job. Thanks very much. Larry, on to De La Hoya versus Trinidad September 18. Your thoughts?
Well, it's great to want to be great. Both of these fighters want to be great, and they will decide it in the ring in what is probably the biggest fight below the heavyweight division since Hagler and Leonard more than a decade ago. I can't draw any lessons from tonight's fight, perhaps, but just generally off the top of my head, it seems that Trinidad is a more polished boxer, a two-handed puncher, but that doesn't mean he's a better fighter. And just as Oba Carr said in the ring a moment ago, the tougher man, the man who shows more spirit, more ability to deal with adversity, is the fighter that will come through in that fight.
And in theory, we'll find out on September 18 right here at the Mandalay Bay who that man is. Tonight on World Championship Boxing, you got to see two of the five or six best pound-for-pound fighters in the world. In the next couple of weeks, you'll be seeing two more of them. We'll have a final word on what happened here in the ring in just a moment. Right now, let's look ahead to a couple of more upcoming programs on HBO.
On the next Real Sports,
ethnic Albanian boxer Elvir Merici came to America with hopes of becoming a champion. As his family returns to Kosovo, risking their lives, Elvir's biggest fight may be with his conscience. Plus, fires, looting, running wild in the streets. Is this any way for fans to show support for their team?
We're not people anymore. Just this mass of destructive energy.
Winner of three 1998 Sports Emmys, Real Sports with Brian Gumbel. Premieres Tuesday night at 10 on HBO.
Nothing is out of bounds.
This spring, travel off the beaten path and surrender to the irresistible force of the tropics.
Trinidad steps in to try to finish the man.
Triumphant champion Felix Trinidad returns home to Puerto Rico and turns up the heat against top-ranked contender Hugo Pineda for the World Welterweight Championship. Be there live Saturday, May 29th, only on HBO, the heart and soul of boxing.
On June 5, light heavyweight champion Roy Jones faces fellow champion Reggie Johnson to the win of the title of the only undisputed champion in boxing today. 2 weeks later on Boxing After Dark, Michael Grant, one of the premier young heavyweights, meets veteran Lou Savarese. On Monday, June 21, we'll begin our 25th year of Wimbledon tennis as HBO Sports presents 59 hours of weekday action from the opening round through the semifinal, followed each night by a one-hour highlight show.
this evening here at the Mandalay Bay in Las Vegas, throw-in Justin Jukov fought valiantly and very well for 8 rounds against Floyd Mayweather Jr. before Mayweather, in defense of his world 130-pound championship, TKO'd Jukov with hard right hands in the ninth. And then Oscar De La Hoya was put through some strenuous activity by Oba Carr, though he knocked Carr down in the first round and later got 2 penalty points against Carr. De La Hoya was still stressed as he went to the 11, where he landed big left-hand shots that knocked out Carr. 31st straight win for Oscar. Coming up immediately following tonight's coverage of World Championship Boxing, stay tuned for Cobra on the East Coast and The Lesson Before Dying on the West Coast. So now for Larry Merchant, George Foreman, and Harold Lettman, I'm Jim Lampley saying so long from the Mandalay Bay. The executive producer of HBO Sports is Ross Greenberg. Tonight's telecast of World Championship Boxing was produced by Rick Bernstein and directed by Mark Payton. Feature producers John Crystal and Thomas Odelfelt. The associate directors Greg Backer and Brian McDonald. Assistant to producer Matt Boland. The production manager was Mark Hayden. The technical supervisor Bob Hunter. And the technical director was Doug Goetz.
This has been a presentation of HBO Sports, the network of champions.